Hey friends and family, I'm Ariel, the worship leader here at Gateway Church, and we're so excited that you've landed on our YouTube page. It's going to be a great day, and we're ready. So you can follow us on our social media pages. On Instagram, it's called Gateway Online, and on Facebook, you just type in Gateway Church Shreveport and click the like button. You can also download our church app, which has a lot of awesome resources. Now, we're about to get into this message that Pastor Dustin is about to preach. So, get ready. We're excited to see you soon.
You that are tuning in online, would you just comment there in the comment section? Let us know that you're watching, like, and share. You can do that as well. You can take your phone out like you've been doing from week to week and go to our live stream and just share that so the message gets out to your friend and your family. Amen? Amen. Well, let me just kind of update us on where we are at and what is going on. I don't know if you slowed down when you were coming in, but there have been many updates made to the foyer. Aren't things looking good around here? Amen? Well, I guess there's three of you that thought so. We're trying. But hey, some things that you want to know, like housekeeping things with what's happening, being in-house now. So many of you are here. We have a lot more seats. So you that are going to trickle back in over the next few weeks and into the months, we'll get more seats out for you as well. But our prayer stations are on the sides of our sanctuary now. So when we begin to start having prayer and a part of that, this is kind of our welcome back celebration service. We'll have people that are working and praying for you. We have hand sanitizer there. And what I'm encouraging you to do, the first thing is practice self-care, watching and caring for your own life. I can't tell everybody else what to do. I can encourage, but that's going to be on you to do it. If you want to wear a mask, wear a mask. If you don't want to shake hands, don't. And don't make people feel uncomfortable with the hugging and shaking hands. Just let everybody kind of do what they're going to do. We're not policing in here. We're encouraging you to continue to do what we've been doing, caring for others. Because I do believe that we love our neighbor by caring that way. And we want people to feel comfortable coming back, not feeling awkward or concerned, because we do have real concerns. And we are concerned. And so we are going to have prayer as a part of our service. We ask that you use hand sanitizer before and after. We have some, if you want to just turn around and look, they're on the back wall back there. We have some on the Welcome Center. There are masks on the Welcome Center as well. Those are available for you to wear. And so we're trying to do everything that we can to create the safest environment where we can really just celebrate our faith and worship Jesus. We don't want it to be about a bunch of rules and regulations. We just want to be mindful of everyone. Does that kind of make sense how we're viewing all of this? There's a lot of stuff that's happening in the world around us. There is. And there are many things that we're seeing both on the news and social media in our own streets. And so what we need is Jesus. Amen. And we need to take Jesus to those places. And that's why we come in here, to be encouraged in our faith. Well, let's just kind of catch back up as we begin to move into the message this morning. So I want to introduce our new sermon series that we have coming in by first just addressing where we've been. We started this year, believe it or not, we are in June. Isn't that crazy? We are in June, but we started this year with our theme as recalibrate, a divine reset. And so the past few months, I've been talking to you about how the quarantine was a silver lining, that we had the silver lining in the quarantine, that we could reset and reposition before God. That we don't see it as a setback, but that you see it as a setup, an opportunity for you to reset and reposition your life before God. And so we have all had the opportunity to identify what are the essentials. What's most essential in your family life? What's most essential in your home? And society and our government officials have been telling us what the essential workers are, but you personally have had an opportunity to reset the things in your life that needed to be reset. You had an opportunity to reposition things in your life that needed to be repositioned. What is and was most essential for you and your family? My wife and I have been talking and reflecting on those things that are most important in our family and getting back to the basics and the essentials for us, our marriage, raising our children, and in our relationship with the Lord. And so this series that we are going to begin over the next several weeks is called Restart. Would you say that with me this morning? Restart. You know, we're reopening the church. We're restarting a lot of things that had been put on hold. And so as we think about this idea of restarting, it's a new beginning, a fresh start to start anew. And you and I all have the opportunity to come back together and determine what is most important, or we could say it as what are the essentials in your life. What matters most when it comes to assembling together? Our services will probably be a little shorter for a time being as we strip things back and focus on the most important things. And for you, I know that's been your fellowship, the community, that koinonia, being able to see face to face. Yeah, social media is great. You get to see the pictures, you get to watch the videos, but there's a value of assembling together. There's a value of seeing each other's facial expressions. The smile when you see someone that you know and have a relationship. There's a value to worshiping together in the same room with everyone. There's a value of getting to see in more detail the facial expressions of the preacher. There's a value of hearing others respond. I can't tell you how many times I'd be looking into that camera preaching and wondering, is there anybody even listening? Is there anybody even there? And it would be this mental challenge. I'd have to hurdle over it to be like, keep preaching. Somebody's going to watch it. Somebody's listening. I may not see or hear an amen. I may not feel the expression or the immediate feedback, but I know somebody's out there. Somebody's out there. But it was a challenge. And so getting to see all of you this morning, feeling the warmth of your energy, that is an essential. And so here we are. We're beginning this series, and I'm entitling it Restart. There'll be some readjustments. Get that word re. You know, the prefix re, again and again. That's the idea. We're getting back to that place of doing things again. And so if you hear me utilizing words in our English language that begin with re, there's going to be a lot of intentionality with that. Recalibrate, right? A divine reset. We're restarting. And the title of this morning's message is Reopen Your Bible. Reopen your Bible. You know, as I get into the mode of restarting our Sunday morning service with actual people in the sanctuary, you know, we had a little pop-up sermon preaching worship set that y'all seen. It was set up right here in front, and we would come in and we would do everything, record it, we would edit it and put it up there. And as we're restarting with all of this, I know that you're like me, and there's been times in your life where you wish that you could go back in time. And maybe you've even said this to yourself, but if you could go back and talk to the younger you, what would you say? Anybody in here ever been in a discussion where you're like, if I could just go back and talk to the younger version of me, I would tell me that. You ever been there? You ever heard somebody talk about that? You know, for me, if I could go back and talk to younger Dusty, what would I tell myself? You know, I think the first thing for me, what I would tell younger Dusty, let's say make it at 15 years old. If I could go back and talk to 15-year-old Dusty, I'd say give your life to Jesus sooner. For me, because of what happened in my life when Jesus revealed himself to me and I accepted Jesus, priority to me, Dusty, give your life to Jesus sooner. Then I'd say some things like, you know, don't be afraid to fail, Dusty. Take more chances. Spend more time with your family. You know, you're going to be hurt, Dusty, and you're probably going to hurt others. Just be ready for that in life. I'd probably tell younger Dusty that bad things are going to happen to good people. You know, that'd be something I'd tell me. I'd say, you know what? You can do all the right things, but it may not turn out as you hoped. But keep doing the right thing, Dusty. Just because I do the right thing, Dusty, doesn't mean it's always going to turn out the way that you want, but always try to do the right thing. It was interesting this past week. I was praying. I didn't have this introduction for the message. In fact, I had been praying and asking the Lord what the series was going to be. I had an idea, but it wasn't developed, and it wasn't until Friday morning that it started to develop in my heart of exactly what it would be. But in my prayer this week, I was praying for my children. So they're up here on the front row, and I was praying for Ariella and Grable. And I just noticed that in my prayer, it started to go, Lord, protect them and keep them safe. Don't let anything bad happen to them. And I went through this, and I was like, hold on a second. I know they're going to go through some stuff. Me praying this prayer doesn't mean they're never going to face any hardship, troubles, and trials. It doesn't mean that nobody's ever going to bully them. It doesn't mean that nobody's ever going to say a hurtful thing to them. It doesn't mean they're never going to be betrayed. And my prayer shifted, and I said, you know what, Lord? I know how I need to raise my kids, and thinking back on this, what I do need to teach them is how to handle it when those kind of things happen, how to respond, how to deal with the bitterness or the anger or the frustration that infects your heart because somebody said something evil to you or people were talking about you behind your back. And I begin to think about the younger me and the lessons, and this started to develop after the prayer. If I could go back and just restart, what would I say? And it started to help me with my parenting as I would raise my children. If I could go back and talk to younger me, well, I have an opportunity to talk to younger me and how I would teach them and help them. And so this morning, as we get into this idea of restarting, you are positioned to restart some things in your life. And for you that felt comfortable, and not in a shaming or even a condemning way, because we're not going to do that around here if some are going to start to trickle back. But for you that felt comfortable this morning, this was your restart. My family is prioritizing this, and we feel comfortable at this moment. Others are going to start to feel more comfortable as the days go by. But for you, you are establishing right now what matters most. Gathering together in the house, this building, to worship, to encourage, to be encouraged, and to hear the word preached, and then to respond to the word. That's what you're establishing this morning. And so the word I want to give you this morning is found out of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. If you've got your Bibles, turn with me, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Normally, I read to you out of the New Living Translation, but this morning, I'm going to use the New International Version. Give me an amen or two if you're there. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Amen. You know, I'm just going to go ahead and put this little plug in there. It's okay to have a little more energy this morning. Come on, it's okay to be a little excited. I know you haven't done this in a while, and you probably haven't amened as loud when you were sitting in front of your phone or your computer, but you're back together. It's okay to be excited to be in here. It's okay to amen. It's okay to clap. It's okay to jump up and down. It's okay if you want to stand. It's okay to do that. Let me just get that out of the way, and so you can get excited. It's okay to talk back to the preacher. It really is okay in here to do that. Amen? There we go. Now we are back in it. 2 Timothy, let's read it. All scripture is God-breathed, and it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Well, if you've been watching Wednesday nights, you know that when we start to study the Bible, you want to make some observations. You want to see what is there. And if you're like me, immediately the word all grabbed my attention. All scripture, it's clear, if we can go back to verse 16, it's God-breathed. We're going to talk about that in just a second. God-breathed this word. It came out of God's mouth. The word of God is profitable. It's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And then there's this word in there, so. And when you see the word so or for in the scriptures, it gives an explanation. So you want to know why it's good for and what it's good for? The Bible tells us. It's right there. And we're going to look at this and figure out how we can extract that timeless truth this morning and apply it to our lives. And so our title this morning is what? Reopen your Bibles. As we're restarting, we want to begin with a foundational principle for our lives, and that is you need to reopen your Bible. I don't know what your Bible reading's been like over the last 3 months that you haven't been in church, but wherever you are, I'm encouraging us that as we restart, you reopen your Bibles. I know that many of us have fallen prey to this. We've turned on our televisions, we've listened to the news, we've opened up our social media apps, and we've listened to what others have had to say. We've listened to videos, we've listened to short videos, we've listened to people on the radio, we have listened to podcasts. But what I want to ask us this morning, have we opened our Bibles? When we look at what is happening in the world around us, have you listened to the Word of God? We are listening to so many voices around us that are seeking to fill our mind with a certain perspective. There is an agenda on both sides. There are political affiliations and political motives and agendas, news that have their propaganda. But I don't care about all that this morning. I want to know, have you opened your Bible? Are you listening for God this morning? Have you weighed our troubles, our trials, our challenges in the balance of God's Word? Is that where you're at this morning? As you walk back into this room, what has the loudest voice? Who has the strongest opinion? When you are weighing everything around you, what's going on in your children's life? What's going on in your marriage? What's going on in your workplace? What's going on in our community, in your neighborhood? What you're seeing on your Facebook feed? What you're seeing on Instagram? How have you weighed that in the balance of what God has to say? What I have found is that my Bible tells me and will still tell me that Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there is no other. Jesus is the way. Let me say it again. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. And so today I am standing here in this very pulpit to challenge you. And even if it needs to be a correction for how you have been living and doing, my word for you that I am calling this church to do, and anybody that will listen, reopen your Bibles. To our online family that is watching this morning, open your Bibles. Let God speak into your situation. Let God speak into your family. Let God speak into everything that you are facing. This is our restart. This is our divine reset. This is our moment to reset and reposition ourselves before God. We need to recalibrate. We need to sync up with God's heart and mind so that you can discover God's heart, discover God's will. And there's no better place to do that than in God's Word. Start small, start simple. But when I look at our text and I make the observations, I see that the source of the Word is God. All Scripture is God-breathed. This isn't man's opinion. They didn't get it from some news source. They didn't get it from some king. They got it from God himself. God spoke and men wrote. The origin, the content of the Holy Word that you see came from the very breath of God, the living God. The Holy Spirit spoke and men wrote. It is our counsel. It is the final instruction. It is the rule for our faith. It is the canon, the measure. Stick. You want to know how to live and why you should be living and what you should be living for? Pull out the Word of God. It's profitable. It's useful to encourage us, to instruct us, to rebuke us, to guide us. This is what the Word of God is for. It is not man-made, man-constructed, but it is God-given. The source of these words is God. Amen? 2 Peter tells us this. It'll be up on the screen. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. He didn't write down his own interpretation of things. He didn't write down what he felt. He wasn't putting a journal together. Listen to what it says. For prophecy never had its origin in the human will. Never. Never had its origin in the human will. But prophets, through though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by who? The Holy Spirit. Reopen your Bible. God's Word is infallible. It is without error. It is without mistake. It is without fault. And it should be, come on, church, it should be the final rule for your faith and how you live your life. Your first response Come on. What does the Word of God say? Reopen your Bible. If you don't follow the Word of God for the final rule for your faith and living, then to deny it, to reject it, to disobey it is to disobey God. If your first move is not what does God say, what does the Word say, there's a very strong possibility that you may allow the opinions of others to begin to guide and shape your life. When we reject and neglect the Word of God, we begin to quench, drive out, push out the Holy Spirit from our lives. And I remind you what Paul said to the church at Ephesus. In the second chapter, he says that the Spirit, the evil one, the prince of the power of the air, the ruler in the unseen world, he is at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. The moment we begin to shift and do it my way, do it the tradition's way, do it Facebook's way, I begin to push God out. I begin to quench the Holy Spirit, and I begin to make room for the enemy to work in my life. This is exactly why God spoke to the prophet Samuel, and Samuel said that obedience is better than sacrifice, for rebellion is witchcraft. Witchcraft because there's a controlling spirit behind it that wants to control and manipulate. And this is why that delayed obedience is disobedience. Why that obedience to God's word is the highest form of worship that you could possibly give. Your obedience into his word is an exercise of your faith. And so when you are called to obey, obedience is better than sacrifice. Rebellion is the sin of witchcraft. When we do not come to God's counsel first, we are giving ourselves an opportunity to give access to our heart, give our heart access to the enemy. Our first response, I want you to hear it again, should always be, what does God's word say? How does the word say that I should respond? What am I challenging us to do this morning? Reopen your Bible. There are voices all around you. There are opinions all around you. You may get text messages. You may get Facebook messages. You may get emails. You may get phone calls. You may hear conversations in your workplace. You may turn it on the television and watch it. But get back to the place. It's not old-fashioned. It's not a tradition. It is a relationship with God is marked by reopening your Bible and reading and discovering God's heart and God's mind. The second thing I see when I look at our text this morning is that the Word of God, when I reopen my Bible, is the guide. Say guide with me. It is the guide for my life. How am I going to guide my life? How am I going to know that I'm on the right path? How am I going to know that I'm leading my children on the right path? How am I going to know that I'm leading my family on the right path? How do I know that I'm leading the church on the right path? The Word of God is the guide for my life. When I open the pages of Scripture, I'm going to continue to say, I discover the heart of God right here. I discover the will of God right here. The text tells me that the Bible is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. It's the guide for how you're going to live and measure everything that you do. The Word of God, it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, is living and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the division of soul and marrow. It gets down inside of us. And the Bible goes on to say, it is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of your heart. It doesn't just look at the superficial. The Word of God is going to evaluate and assess the motive. God is interested in your motive, the why behind what you do. And the Word of God guides us so that we can offer up pure worship to God, that my actions have filtered through all of the junk that can get in the way, and that I can present something pure before the Lord. The way you're going to do that, church, come on, hear me now, is you get in your Word. You allow the Holy Spirit and the Word of God to partner, and they shape you, and they train you to think and live a different way. Our text literally says it's useful for doing this, teaching you, rebuking you, correcting you, training you. It trains you how to live a godly life. The Word of God is powerful in this way. And you know what? We have a lot of good Christian witnesses around us. You can look to your left and your right, and you can see some good, solid Christians. But there is no clearer picture of who Jesus is than in your Bible. I'm going to say it again. There is no clearer picture of who Jesus is than in your Bible. The Bible clearly defines right and wrong. It clearly defines good and bad, how I should treat people, how I should respond to their pain and their sin. I want to know how to live my life and respond to the troubles and trials in my life. I learn in the Word how to weep with those who weep, to rejoice with those who rejoice. I learn to mourn with those that are in pain. I learn to comfort those in need. I learn that I'm a part of a body. It's not just about me. I learned that we are one. And when one hurts, we should all hurt. When one weeps, we should all weep. I believe that when we hurt one another, we inflict wounds on the body because we are one. The Bible teaches me this. I open it up and I find there's never, never, church, a time to hate. There's never a time to cut down. There's never a time to belittle. I find in my Bible that as believers, as Christ followers, I am to have compassion on others. I am to love others. I am to make allowance for each other's faults. I am to be merciful and kind. I am to be gentle. I am supposed to model the Christ that is found in the pages of Scripture. You want to know how to respond to the pain and the hurt around us? Open your Bibles. Reopen your Bibles. Don't get caught up in a political affiliation. Don't get caught up in I'm conservative and they're liberal. Don't get caught up in I'm a Republican and they're Democrat. You're none of those things, and none of those things are going to define you. You are a kingdom person. You are part of the priesthood of all believers. You are a Christian and you happen to be in this world. Jesus trumps everything. I don't care who my president is and who my president will be. I'm not saying good or bad, one or the other. I'm just saying Jesus is my king and my allegiance is to Jesus. And my love is found in him because I love because he first loved me. I'm calling us back to the heart of the Scriptures. It's easy to get off and get sidetracked, and it sounds good and it sounds right, but I'm calling us this morning to restart and reopen our Bibles. A hurting world needs Jesus. A quarantined world needs Jesus. A sick world needs Jesus. A broken world needs Jesus. In my Bible, in your Bible, it's the same one, whether it's a different version or not. It's going to teach you and I how to live like Jesus lived. It's going to show you how to love like Jesus loved. It's going to show you how Jesus responded to the worst situations. It's going to show you how Jesus responded to difficult people. It's going to show you how Jesus responded to those that were hurting, those that were dealing with pain, those that were broken, those that were weighed down, those that were fearful. Jesus is going to show you and I how to do that. This nation, more than ever, needs you to love like Jesus. This nation, I'm going to tell you right now, and you can hate me for it, doesn't need you to win a debate in a comment section on Facebook. It ain't going to do it. I don't think I've met too many people that have ever had their life changed from a comment thread on Facebook. I don't know that I've met any, but I'm just leaving a little room. But you get what I'm saying? What they need you to do, honestly, they need you to love them like Jesus would love them. They may say something you don't like. You know what? I just told you earlier, when I look back on 15-year-old me, there's going to be a lot of people that say stuff you don't like, and it ain't going to stop now. One I left out is that, Dusty, you're not going to be able to fix everything, and some things you just ain't going to fix, and some things just don't need fixed. Some things I'm just going to have to let Jesus fix. But I'm always called to love. I'm always called to encourage. Next thing I see here in our text is that I should build my life on the Word. So I see that the source of the Word is God himself. A man may have wrote it, but he got it from God. He didn't put his own opinion in it. He didn't put his own interpretation of things into it. He wrote what God told him to write. Second thing I see there is that the Word, when I reopen my Bible, is the guide for my life. The third thing I see here is that you are to build your life on the Word. Let's say that this morning. Build your life on the Word. 2 Timothy, our text, 3:17. so that all God's people may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Greek language behind this passage is actually saying, in order that the person of God be proficient, fully equipped for every good work. The word proficient, you got to hear it, is competent or skilled. If you want to know how to live your life, if you want to know how to build your life, the Word of God is going to allow you to be proficient, competent, and skilled in doing so. While you may learn a thing or two by watching others, the Word of God is the primary source to make you proficient, to make you competent, to make you skilled in living as a Christ follower. For you to live, now hear this, for you to live a life pleasing to God, you have to measure your living according to the Word of God. Just because my wife gives me the approval on something doesn't mean I please Jesus. Just because you give me a pat on the back and say, good job, Dusty, doesn't mean I please Jesus. Just because I found some people on social media to agree with me doesn't mean I please Jesus. Just because I can find a group of people that will come along and have the same thinking of me doesn't mean I'm pleasing Jesus. It doesn't. For you to be competent, for you to be skilled, for you to be proficient, for you to do this thoroughly equipped, thoroughly wholeness. The Word of God is your tool for doing so. And you have to guard this. I'm going to go back and say it again. What does the Bible say? How does the Bible say you should respond to that? For you to live a life pleasing to God, you have to measure it in and according to the Word of God. How many of you ever heard in here of the little phrase armchair quarterback? Anybody ever heard of an armchair quarterback? Well, an armchair quarterback is the guy or the gal that sits in their recliner, and they prop their arms up on the chair, and they watch their football game, and they are not out on the field, and the majority of them never played football, maybe outside of peewees or high school. There may have been a time or two that some of them played in college, but the majority of our armchair quarterbacks have never been on the field and played in the NFL. They've never thrown a ball with these men that are 350 pounds and 6'7" coming after you, trying to rip your head off. But they know how to make all of the judgments, know all of the plays, and if they were there, they would have called it this way, said it that way, and they would have known they shouldn't have rolled this way or rolled that way, and he should have passed it instead of running. That's an armchair quarterback is the play caller from his home. He's able to make all of the proficient judgments according to the game. And what I have found in my Christian living is that I liken armchair quarterbacks to armchair Christians. Now hear me on this one when I say this. So the armchair quarterback is, you know, someone that doesn't actually play or participate in the game itself, but they make the judgments on how the quarterback's supposed to do his job. And we get armchair Christians who, you know, they're really not too involved, and they are very familiar with things. They can even come to church on a regular basis, and they see how it all works, but they really don't open their Bible. They're a little familiar with things because they've heard a message a time or two, but they're really not so in it that they can really make a right judgment. And so they're the sideline play callers, if you will. They've watched a lot, but they've never really been in the game. And so why do I bring this illustration up? Because there's this little passage that I find in the book of James that speaks so deeply and profoundly, yet it's so simple. And I'm going to read that to you. James chapter 1, some of you can quote this. Verse 22 through 24, it says this. Do not merely listen to the word. You know where I'm going. Don't merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. The armchair quarterback has deceived themselves that they really know better than Bill Belichick. They really know more than the professional coach. They really know more than the million-dollar quarterback who's been playing football all of his life. They deceive themselves to think they actually know more than the paid professional. And so we look at this and we say, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Those who listen to the word but do not do what it says are like people who look at their faces in a mirror, and after looking at themselves, they go away and immediately forget what they look like. Well, how does it apply to us? Well, we can come in on a Sunday morning. We can hear the word, look at our face in the mirror, and then we walk out and forget everything that we heard. But we're going to restart this morning, and we're going to reopen our Bible, and we're not going to merely listen to what it says, but we're going to put into practice what it says. We're going to respond to the world around us by applying the Word of God to it. We're going to apply the Word of God to my relationships, to the ones that are sitting in front of you, to the ones that are sitting beside you. And we're going to reopen our Bibles and say, what does God's Word say about this? And we're going to allow the Word to shape us, because for us to be proficient, for us to be competent, for us to be skilled, thoroughly equipped for every good work, we have to open up the Word of God. We have to know it. We have to read it and obey it. Yes, I know you're going to open it up and there's going to be some stuff you don't understand, but I assure you that there is enough that you will understand that will transform your life. And the more that you're involved in the Wednesday night Bible study, I guarantee you, you're going to learn more and more about studying the Bible. Because if you're not there, trust me, I know what I'm giving you on Wednesday night. I know the content of this. And I know that if you will just listen and apply, you will learn how to better study the Scriptures. If you'll take notes, you're going to learn some stuff. Some stuff you're going to learn on a college level, I guarantee you. Because I know what I learned it in, whether it was undergrad or whether it was in postgrad. So, you know what? If you're going to get some stuff, you're going to get some good stuff. I bring us to a close before we have communion there. And if you're watching online, I encourage you to get your communion ready. We're going to close with our last point here. I'm going to invite our worship team to come back up on the platform. And I'm going to close us with what I would believe is a very relevant litmus test. If I'm opening my word, if I'm allowing God to speak to my life. I talked to the staff about this in our staff meeting 2 weeks ago. And God had been speaking to me about something in a relevant litmus test. So what does God have to say? What does the Word have to say? Deals with how you handle disagreements. How you handle disagreements. You know, in my relationship with my wife, what tells me a lot about her, who she is as a person, what tells her a lot about who Dusty is as a person, is how we treat each other when we disagree. Because the Bible tells me some things. If when she and I get into an argument, if I start calling her names, if I start trying to put her down, if I start trying to belittle her, then you know what? I am revealing some things about what's inside me. And she is learning some things about what kind of a person I am by the way that we disagree. See, you can't live without disagreeing with others, and you can't live with others you disagree with if you don't disagree rightly. No matter what relationship you're going to be in this church, in your home, at your workplace, there's going to be times that you disagree with each other. But how you disagree with each other matters, because disagreeing is a part of life. And I'm going to read it just like I wrote it here. The how we disagree is what will affect the relationship. It will be the determining factor for what quality the relationship will have after the disagreement comes to a close. If every time you get in a disagreement, you bring up all the times that something ever happened bad in the relationship, if I keep a record of every wrong that Chantal has ever done to me and I throw that back up in her face, how do you think that's going to make her feel? It's going to make her feel pretty bad, but it's also going to make her to start to realize, maybe I don't have the relationship with God that I say I have. I know it's quiet, but the Bible tells me that love is patient, love is kind, love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. Love keeps no record of when it has been wronged. I am best loving my wife when I truly forgive and let it go. And how we disagree in our world around us. Why I said this is a relevant test, because as you start to think about how you're disagreeing with what's happening in the world around you. Come on. How you're disagreeing with the world around you is revealing what's in your heart. And you know, I've talked about, we all got an ugly button. Come on, you remember the ugly button story. We got that button that when somebody pushes our button, the ugly stuff starts to come out. Bible talked about it like this, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. But the ugly button is we find the junk in our life sometimes. It just takes somebody to push the right button. And a lot of times it's when you're scrolling through your Facebook feed and you've read something and they push the button when you read it. But I tell you this, John 13:35 says, by this, Come on, you remember this one. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you what? Love one another. How you treat one another is going to speak to who you belong to. And I'm calling us this morning to reopen our Bibles and let the Word shape how you treat other people. Let the Word shape your life. It will make you proficient in your living for Jesus. Are you with me this morning? And I think that as we come to the place of having communion this morning, so you can go ahead and get that ready. You that are watching online, you have that ready this morning. And I think there's such a beautiful story that happened around the table when Jesus participated in communion with his disciples. I'm kind of practicing one-handed here with this. And I know this is our first Sunday back, our first time having communion together in 3 months. And as you get ready there, I want you to just kind of pause and think about who were at the table with Jesus. Take a moment here and think. There were different levels of relationships that sat around the table. There were 12 plus Jesus. There were the intimate three, Peter, James, and John. There was the closest one, John the Beloved. And then there was the one that may have been the outcast, and that was Judas. But if John 13:35 tells me this, by this they will know that we are his disciples by our love for one another. Jesus didn't treat anybody different at that table. He made available to everyone at the table the same thing he makes available to you that are here this morning. And he went through what he was providing, this bread. He said, this is my body that was given for you. And it was given for each of us and the opportunity to receive this morning. And so as we take this bread this morning, I'd ask right where you're at that we would just all hold this up this morning, just even as a symbol before us, a reminder that we put right there in front of us. And I want to pray over us, and you can pray right where you're at together. That Lord Jesus, I begin by saying thank you for modeling before us love. And here in communion, we see the ultimate example and demonstration of love. And that is that the Son of God who left heaven and came to us, he laid down this body and he said it is given for us. And by this, oh God, we would know that you loved us and that you demonstrated it for us. And to those that sat at the table with you, and to we that sit in this room that watch online, we receive this morning your love. We receive this morning your provision. And we take together this morning the body, the bread of Christ in Jesus' name. Let us take together. And as Jesus transitioned and he stated that this cup was his blood. And that with a few hours, he would give his life. He would have nails that would be driven through his hands and his feet. And he would pay the ultimate price for our sins. And he took that cup and he blessed it. And he told the disciples. And as we hold up the cup this morning, and you that are watching online, we remind ourselves of what Jesus did for us. He did it then and he's done it now. And so, Lord Jesus, I thank you for this ultimate provision and sacrifice that you modeled before us. The testimony of how I am to love a broken and a hurting world. The testimony of how I am to love my neighbor, to love our church family, those that don't agree with me, those that would betray me, This is how you love Judas. This is how you love those that would nail you to the cross. You laid down your life for them. And so this morning, we receive what you provided. And we thank you for it this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us take together. I want to ask us this morning, we're going to close with singing How Deep the Father's Love. I ask you just to stand with us and sing this last song. I'll close us with prayer. Our giving will do as you leave out this morning. If you want to give your tithes and your offering, you can do so in the giving boxes that are located at the back of the sanctuary. You that want to give online, we still have all of those features available, those platforms available. You can still text 77977 GW Shreve. You can still do that. You can still do it on our website. You can do it right here in the sanctuary as well. But the team is going to lead us this morning in that song. What I hope is that we would just, in a sense, marinate in this, his love for you. Yes, you've been isolated for some time, but God's love hasn't changed. Amen. I'll close us with prayer when the team is done singing this morning.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turned his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Thank you, Jesus. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. Has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Oh, Jesus, we thank you. Thank you for your love. In anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from you? God, I thank you so much for paying our ransom. God, thank you for paying the price for us, Jesus. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, let me just say one more time, it is so good to see you this morning. Thank you for choosing to worship at Gateway Church. Thank you for watching online. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you. Amen. Go be like Jesus. Reopen the Bible.